Welcome to a broadcast, and we're going to get into some very heavy content, as you can imagine, as we always do. I'm pushing things so fast that yesterday I actually reached a low point. I was actually feeling a little bit suicidal, even. It's like, oh my God. You know, I said, well, I'll bounce back from this, but still, this feeling miserable because of the burden and responsibility and pressure that is upon me. But today I've bounced back really well. I got some sleep, and I'm forging ahead very, very quickly now, as we need to forge ahead. So we are going to start off in just full blast here, full blast. As I've said, Jesus is back in this world as his attention. Now, I don't know if that's in a body or not a body, but the focus, the intention, and there's a purpose for it, you could say. In alignment with that, as someone who actually greeted him, as he asked who wants to relate with me, and I said, okay, I will. I didn't see anybody else raising their hand. I said, well, you know, I'm not going to just have a shutout, get Jesus shut out here. I'm going to go ahead, whatever it is. Because of that, it seems like I have this responsibility to say a few things. And one of them is to do a review of Christianity. Because we're ready to move on. And what I've said, that Christianity has actually been a side trip. It's been a side trip. And so I've had to go back and look at it, and there's something I need to say about it to sum it all up. And it's better that I say it than some other means of summing it up, because I have been schooled in the intermediate step that Jesus' teaching is really about, the intermediate step, forgiveness, and the intermediate step, and the honoring of our creativity. Therefore, I'm able to do it in a way which is kind and gentle and just and right for everyone. But I do say Christianity has been a side trip. And as far as all the doctrinal Christological debates that arose, here's what I have to say about all this. They're all wrong. They're all wrong. Whether, you know, diaphysite, miaphysite, adoptionism, you go on and on and on and on and on. All Christology is mistaken, that is traditional. It's all mistaken, whether it's the Roman Catholic, whether it's the Eastern Orthodox, whether it's the Oriental Orthodox, yeah, okay, which includes, you know, let's keep in mind that Christianity was very strong in Egypt to start out with, actually, and Egypt was really the home of a great deal of Christianity. The Desert Fathers fanned out from Alexandria and lived in the desert, and that's where monasticism started, and that became the model for the Christianity that spread throughout the Holy Roman Empire area, Europe, and the whole Roman Empire area, and really throughout the world. Early missionaries like Thomas was sent to India, and they were sent to Persia, Arabia, Nubia, which is Ethiopia area. And there was vibrant Christianity was spreading very quickly in the first 5-6 centuries, and it kept on spreading. And so Egypt was very, very prominent. These monasticism started there. And there was a school of catechism in Alexandria, which was the main school in the world, catechetical school of Alexandria. And this is where the Christian scholars, intellectuals, philosophers, those doctors of the church, doctrine, Origen was there. This is where they all came and studied, and they're trying to figure out what was this birth that took place. And they came up with all this dogma that has guided Western civilization the last 2,000 years, and through extension much of the world. We've been living under this burden, actually. It's a side trip. And awakening from this is quite a shock. It's quite difficult and tiring. And sometimes, I get down. I'm kind of like shocked, like, wow, you know, this is really something. But, you know, bounce back. I'm able to bounce back and get going again. But there's been some heavy blows, you know, landed upon me as far as just the wow of this. Holy cow. we're able to get a really great picture. And in order to truly go forward, we need to summarize all of this in the right way. And there is a way to summarize it, actually. There is a way to summarize it, and there is a way to move on. And it's very simple. And I call this doctrine the doctrine of accommodation. Doctrine of accommodation. This replaces the Christology of the past. And we're replacing it because it was mistaken. In accommodation, let me explain it. We'll go into explanation of this. What it basically says is that Jesus was accommodating our pretensions. But in order to explain that, you have to explain everything. Basically, is that there is no human nature whatsoever. The flesh has no nature to it. Hypostasis, which is a Greek word, substance of existence, a basic substance of existence, a characteristic. There isn't any hypostasis of human nature. So the church fathers are all concerned about how do you unite the human with the divine, and how do you account for this, etc., etc. And this is a false premise. There isn't any human nature at all. Never has been. The body is actually completely neutral, has no nature to it whatsoever. It's like a symbol. And what we're doing is spirit is projecting upon the body all these characteristics. They're simply mental projections from spirit. And spirit is divine. So divinity, in God the Son, divinity, spirit, is projecting all of this upon a body and making it seem, pretending as though there is this second nature, human nature. It's all a pretense. So the doctrine of accommodationism is based on the theological understanding that this is all, the world, the universe, etc., is a mental projection, and we're pretending. Why are we doing this? Pretending to be dead. Spirit is trying to pretend to be dead, to die, because it is trying to be greater than God. And this, the original sin, is the sin of arrogance, of course, the spirit wanting to be greater than God. And so spirit is scripting this, is trying to convince an imaginary judge of something able to judge spiritual death, which doesn't exist, because spirit can't die. How can there be a judge of it if it can't? Of the impossible is not possible. We made it up. But spirit believes that if it dies, authentically dies, truly dies, that means that God authentically dies too, which means spirit, the will of spirit, is able to change the will of God, which means spirit is great, has a greater will than God, which means then spirit is somehow able to use that greater will to resurrect from the dead and have a new life, which would be, you know, prime creator. This is the basis for the universe, bodies, worlds, etc. So there isn't any separate world, separate human nature, separate anything. Pretending does not produce a separate hypostasis. Okay, it does not, a subjectivity object. It does not produce a separate existence at all. Just like I can pretend to imitate someone's voice, that doesn't mean that I'm that person. There's some separate, or I'm a separate person from what I was before. It's called pretense. So. The doctrine of pretense is the true theology, is that spirit's only pretending all of this, the same way as we pretend when we dream. We're pretending. So therefore, there isn't any Christology based on any two natures at all. It's all null and void. It's a side trip based on a false premise. So they were trying to figure out truth based on a false premise. And we've been living under this for couple thousand years. Now, so we have we have these dream figures, these stick figures we're projecting upon, thinking that this is authentic death. I just have to wait and believe in it, which is the waitingness, until it actually reaches authenticity. So what did Jesus do? Well, Jesus said, okay, I'm going to project on a body too, pretend. Okay, pretend to a certain degree, so that I can animate a body and walk around and talk with others who are animating, projecting on bodies and animating bodies, and explain to them what's going on. And because that's the only way they'll accept the explanation, because they're insisting that they're dead. They're trying to be dead, so I can't really talk with them directly in spirit. I have to talk with them through the symbols and words, you know, in a world, in a universe. So Jesus simply pretended, and as such, animated a body. Mary never gave birth to spirit. Nothing gives birth to spirit. Spirit is birthless and deathless. So you cannot say Mary's the mother of God or even mother of Christ, as Nestorius said. That's impossible. There isn't any spirit never takes birth or never dies either. It is projecting upon a body. Body is just neutral. So Mary gave birth to the neutral body of Mary gave birth to the neutral body of Jesus, which is just a neutral, completely neutral. There's no homeostasis, hypostasis there whatsoever, no hypostasis, no characteristic, no self-existence. It's a dream figure. It's a symbolic dream figure. That's all it is. So there's no reason to venerate Mary in any way whatsoever as far as that is concerned. So the Mariology is also a side trip. So Jesus said, in order to come here into this world, into this dream world of pretense, as pretends or spirits pretend to be dead, that those who are pretending to be dead desperately trying to make it seem that it's an authentic death, and they don't want anything interfering with that, because they feel the only way that they can ever escape this feeling of being dead is to reach authentic deadness, which then will prove that spirit has a greater will than God. And then from that, once that's proved, then they'll get the happiness. So they're very, very resistant to anything which rocks that boat of feeling like we really are humans, we really are bodies, really in a world, we're really not spirit, we're really human. They say, stay away, stay away, stay away, stay away. I'm trying to reach an authentic death here. You know? So Jesus said, look, okay, I'll tell you what. I'll make some accommodations for you. I'm going to come here, but I'm going to make some accommodations for you. I'm going to accommodate your madness, your predicament. Okay, your predicament. Your silliness, your whimsicality, your predicament. And so the what Jesus did and didn't do is based on this accommodation. He made some accommodations. One of them was the crucifixion and the resurrection. They insisted on this, that because this fits their script of what they believe needs to happen. So Jesus says, okay, I'll go along with that. That's what you're demanding. But before that, you're going to allow me to, you know, witness to the truth of the situation to you in various ways. And they said, okay, we'll allow that. But because of our continuity fear, and backlash of that, the price you have to pay for teaching this and showing us the truth is then you have to then be crucified and resurrected, and you have to go accommodate our script, okay? Which our script is that spirit has to authentically die, and then after authentically dying, spirit then it will be resurrected from this authentic death and be the new prime creator, actually greater than God. So Jesus simply accommodated the demands. Okay, he made some accommodations. So this is the new theology. This is the new Christology, is the doctrine of accommodation. And this absolutely replaces the other. Now, what do we do with history? What do we do with the past? What do we do with Christology, the church, etc., all of this? This is a further teaching here, which I'm giving out, is that it's the same principle as I've been teaching about flattening all concepts, is we flatten it all out, and yet we leave it in its flattened condition, because we want to honor our creativity. We do not want to attack the past. We're not attacking it. We say it was a side trip, but a very creative side trip, okay? We forgive ourselves for going on this side trip because we were trying desperately to reach authentic death, so we couldn't allow the truth in a pure way. We insisted on accommodation, some accommodation, and then we tried to believed that both were true. You know, we denied it was an accommodation. We insisted on an accommodation, then we denied this accommodation. It says, no, this is authentic death, and this has happened. And then it became very, very confusing. So we forgive ourselves entirely for this. We recognize that we were in this dilemma of trying to, you know, we were ignorant, dilemma, arrogant. Arrogance leads to ignorance and pretending. And okay, that's where we were at then. We're no longer there anymore. So we forgive ourselves for that. We don't get angry or anything. It's like, well, I was very creative. I was very resourceful, you know. And on the side trips, it was an extraordinary side trip. What an adventure that was. And so we're not going to attack it. We're not going to try and change it. We're not going to try and destroy it. We're just going to flatten it. So there's no dynamic in it. It's unleavened bread. We're going to flatten it. And it remains there in a flattened condition, as it were. And that's all we need to do. So we need to flatten the past. We need to flatten our concepts. And simply abide in that situation then, where the past is flattened, concepts are flattened, and in that condition of those being flattened, then we simply abide in the totality. That's part of the totality of our experiencing now. Okay. So this is how we move forward. Jesus is back, and he's not bringing all those accommodations like in the past. He says, hey, it's time to relate to me as a friend now. Okay, no more accommodations. So I've been on a fast track, so I'm able to do that. I've been fast tracking my whole life because I knew that he was coming back and there wouldn't be any accommodation. I said, oh boy, you know, how are we going to handle that? It's been extraordinarily difficult. It's quite difficult to get out of all the leavening of history into this unleavened, you know, perspective. But we do have the tools. We have the theological, ideological tools, and the spiritual practice tools of practice, where it's this the neither nor or both practice, which I've introduced here in the previous videos, and I will speak of it. A flattening concepts of both this and that, meaning we're honoring our creativity and all this massive illusion, massive pretense, actually, the massive pretense we've engaged with. We're not attacking it, we're not destroying it, we're not trying to throw it in a garbage dump, we're not trying to do anything. We flattened it, beautifully flattened it, so it's impeccably flattened. And in this flattened state, there's no destruction of it, really. It's just all the leavening has gone out of it, so to speak. And it's just, they're flat. And we appreciate it. We appreciate it because it's appreciation of our own creativity, which is really appreciation of God. And then again, we abide in then the experiencing, which our experiencing will include a, so to speak, a seamless spaciousness, as it were. It will dawn upon us, gradually dawn upon us, that we're in this boundless totality that includes the flattened, unleavened creativity that we've been engaged with, and really self-deception. We'll attempt to be greater than God, and it's been quite an adventure. And this is how we move on. This is how we move on. And we don't judge, you know, who was right, Nestor, Cyril of Alexandria, and the different councils. I mean, it was raggedy. It was very raggedy. All sorts of intrigues, blocking people from attending when you're too late. Different things written and not introduced. I mean, it was just a mess and struggle. And fine, all of that stuff happens when you're trying to continue to maintain the pretense of being dead, spiritually dead. That all sorts of craziness happens, and so we there's no need to judge any of it. We just need to flatten all of it. That's all we need to do, flatten it. And say, if you don't judge, you can flatten it all like this. What keeps us from flattening it is the judgment of it all. So none of it was right. Okay. they were just arguing over semantics, whether it's of or in. You know, is the divine nature is of the word, is of Jesus, of the man, or in the man. There's all these little semantics that they argued over, you know, slight to try and tweak and get what they wanted without giving up their, you know, precious death-like condition, living death condition. Without giving up, without admitting to it's all a pretense. You see, they wouldn't admit to it. And why? Because, well, maybe they thought God was going to be really mad at them for trying to usurp the place of God and kill God. And it took, you know, they just could not believe. It's taken 2,000 years where now we can kind of, you know, say, you know what? I think that God is not mad at us. and we didn't do anything. So Jesus reintroduced his teachings and made it crystal clear. And from looking at that, then we can finally get the courage, you know, just to admit that this is all pretense. And when we are able to admit that, then all these semantic disputes are nothing. You know, it's all illusions are equally untrue. Everything being argued from a false premise, we don't need to judge among those. It's like, which number, you know, what number do you multiply zero by? There's all these arguments about what's going to get the best result. It's like that. And they're arguing over whether, you know, 10 or 11 is the best way to multiply zero to get the best result, to be closest to what they want. It's always going to be zero. You know, arguing from a false premise is always going to be zero. You know, it's not valid. And to say, well, which one was closer is foolish also, because now we have the full clarity of it. And so we don't need to worry about what is closer at all. That becomes a non-starter. It's no longer necessary, right? Because we're not trying to, again, judge the past. We're flattening it all. And certainly, even something that's closer to the truth, if it's not the truth, That is flattened too. That is flattened too. And to say that 1 times 0 is closer to the truth than 100 times 0 is not really true. Is not really true. So we're just introducing this without trying to explain too much, because it's like the wow factor. It's like, wow, we guess we can move forward now, can't we? Absolutely we can. And all the exegetical, hermeneutical studies that are being done, you know, those too, you know, flatten all that out too, because these are all based on premises too, basic premises of the dualistic nature of God being made flesh. This is the whole premise of the whole thing. And this never happened. It's impossible. There is no flesh, actually. The body is neutral. How can God become something that is just a symbol? I mean, God can never become a symbol, actually. Can never be defined. Can never be accurately, truly symbolized at all. So, God did not become flesh at all. So, we don't need to torture ourselves by trying to say, well, what exactly were they saying back then? And because our premises are, well, we know that this is what they meant to say, so, you know, how close did they get to that, or exactly, you know, of course we know, we say, well, we know what the basic creed is, etc. Well, all of that wrong, mistaken premises, being not wanting to blow our cover. This is the whole thing. We don't want to blow our cover. We do not want to realize that this is all completely pretense. Because then we say, oh my gosh, I can't die. It means I can't be greater than God. And then how am I going to protect myself from God's wrath? You know, you're thinking that, right? We think the only way to protect ourselves from God's wrath and thus be happy and safe is for God to die, which means we have to die too. So this is the troubles that we've struggled with. These are the troubles. If we recognize this is all pretensions, you know, God might realize, oh my God, that they're only pretending to be dead, and therefore they haven't really attacked me, and therefore I haven't lost any my will, and therefore, you know, God say, I'm gonna, you know, punish my son is trying to destroy me. But you see, God's will is not threatened at all. This is what Jesus tells us. God's will is not threatened at all. So it takes no notice of it whatsoever. Actually, God has never taken any notice of this silly game directly, but understands that we need a reminder of the truth, which is the Holy Spirit. And that's all. Just remind truth that truth is true. But as far as God being worried or threatened, not at all. Not at all. That's like something like in spaciousness, like a bottle or something, you know. It's like introducing a bottle in spaciousness, and then it put the label on a bottle, like spaciousness, you know. And then thinking that spaciousness is threatened by this bottle because it's got a label on it, calling it spaciousness. It's like, oh, this, as if this is the spaciousness, and spaciousness is somehow appearing in the substrate of the hypostasis of this bottle, you know, like the bottle, because we call it spaciousness, is now the new spaciousness. Do you think pure spaciousness is worried about that, is concerned about that? No more so is God concerned about a silly idea of changing God's will. So it's important because Christianity has been the strongest global ideology in history. There have been others too that are strongly ideological, but Christianity has spread all over the globe and has been very, very prevalent throughout history. And in order to move forward, we need to have a summation of it all, which we've just done here, and say, okay, now we can respectfully, lovingly, honorably flatten it all out, and let that in its flattened condition, let it just stay there. Let it stay there. We don't have to get rid of the past, just flatten it. And eventually, when we're ready, then we'll move on even further. But this is the intermediate step that we take. And whatever fond feelings we have, you know, we can still say that there's at least some symbol representing that. And overall, we always have this feeling of loving our creativity, so we will have this some feeling of love for everything that we've, all the struggle that we've been undergoing, all the craziness, all the funniness, and maybe even at some point we'll even laugh at it, as if it's some fantastic farce that we conjured up. You know, very, very funny farce, actually. It didn't seem funny at the time, but at some point we may see it as very, very funny. And then the symbol, this flattenedness of it, would remind us, yes, that's that. And so this is how it is. We move on. We're not trashing the past. Okay, we're not trashing it. Now, the world has been insisting, the minds of those who are pretending, that I'm here to trash everyone, trash the past, which is probably why my job is to pick up trash. Because this is like a demand, like, you're trying to trash us? Well, we'll show you. We'll give you the punishment of a lifetime of picking up trash, which is basically all I've done my whole life. Which is, you know, but they were mistaken. Again, another false premise. Based on fear, that I came here to trash everything. I did not come here to trash everything. I came here to respect and honor our creativity, and also show everyone the way to move forward, to move on from this. It's enough. We've had enough of pretending to be dead. That's not what God really created us for, to pretend to be dead. Is that what God really said? You know what, Spirit, I'm going to create you, but I want you to do forever and ever and ever is to pretend to not be Spirit, but to pretend to be dead. You know, pretend to not be what you are. You know, that's an absurdity. If that was the case, God would have just directly created whatever God wanted. So it's time to move on from this. And the world interpreted me, my spirit, my tone, an unapologetic tone, as I was here to trash the world, you know. So they said, you know, I guess that punishment has been inflicted upon me by the world, thinking that, you know, this is the accommodation I have to make. Said, oh, you want to trash us? Well, you got to pay the price, and you have to, you know, deal with all the trash that you're going to trash. You know, show us that you love trash. You know, but I'm not trashing. I'm saying flattening is not trashing. Flattening is not trashing at all. And this is what I've seen. In a dream, I saw the whole structure of the world, of the past, you might call it, flattened. And yet there was the beauty. It was you could see the outlines. What are these? Some of these effects in pictures, like the etching effect, where, you know, it seems to flatten everything out, like carved in stone, so to speak. But it's still beautiful. Oh, so it's like the whole thing is just structured into this flat dimension, like etching in an etching. But it's still, you could see the traces of creativity and beauty there. It's still all there. So it's not trash. It's not like a jumble of trash. This is a complete misinterpretation. So hopefully I can finally get out of, you know, the garbage dump by clarifying all this and refuse to, you know, be put, you know, bullied back into that. Which is maybe why my hours are being reduced and reduced and reduced and reduced and reduced. But it is rather funny that the world would view me as just as like the lowest of the low, because it did feel this extremely threatened, you know, like, oh my gosh, here someone's coming to trash everything we've done, because they knew they felt like, and we know deep down that this is, you know, we're all messing up real bad, but so they expect that truth is somehow the wrath of God, so they're still believing the wrath of God. There isn't any wrath of God. So God is not coming to trash anything. And so this is sort of few who can start hearing this and saying, wow, I'm starting to get it. Hey, this is just the message of it's we can move on from this. That's all. In the right way, which is honoring the past. In no way do I want to trash the past, and I don't. I've visited so many churches in my life, and I've enjoyed every single one of them. And I didn't trash the church, you know, when I visited. But I realized, hey, it's time to move on from this, you know. But no, I appreciated everything. It's beautiful. And I could see all the work that everyone, the loving work that everyone has done, the creativity to try and their best to both have their cake and both have truth and be dead, also be dead, you know, and how they could try to do this. And so this is my attitude. I mean, I have very many beautiful beautiful, beautiful pictures. I used to take pictures of churches. I've spent a lot of time in churches, and I've spent my entire life around religion, and especially Christianity. And because I knew at some point I was here to make this summation and help out Jesus, because Jesus is the one who is encouraging us to move on from this. That's all. Jesus is the one who is truly encouraging us, unapologetically encouraging us to truly move on from all of the past. In even the belief in time and all this, but through love and forgiveness and the intermediate step, honoring our creativity. This is at the center of Jesus' teaching. He's not here to trash anything, actually. And there is no wrath of God at all, none whatsoever. So, as I say, it's better for me to say this because, you know, there will be some who truly do want to trash it. I guarantee you this. In fact, these are the currents in the world right now. Religion is in the crosshairs of those who would love to trash it. If you look at the radicals in the Middle East right now, who are trashing all sorts of stuff, aren't they? Blowing up ancient, you know, archaeological places and monuments and history, the past, they're blowing it up, destroying it, viciously destroying it, okay? They're engaged in all sorts of trashing and destruction. And this is something, this is a strong current. And there's many that sympathize with that in many different ways. Of the many liberal progressives in America, they really want to trash Christianity. They really do. They really hate it, and if you left it up into their hands, they would trash it in some way, no question about it. So there's a very strong dynamic in this world right now of wanting to trash the past in order to move on. So I stand as an option to that, not just me, but I mean Jesus is teaching, and as a student of Jesus, I'm speaking out on this, is no, we're not interested in trashing any of that. But we can see it in a flattened way. We can see it devoid of any more dynamics. Okay, it's like seeing all numbers times zero are zero. Therefore, we only need to just see the zero of it, so to speak. And all the numbers are still there, but there's nothing happening between the numbers and the zero. Okay, there's no multiplication, subtraction, division, no yeasty, you know, thinking and ferment and reaction and judging taking place at all. It's devoid of judgment, it's devoid of thinking, it's devoid of valuing, all of that. And yet the numbers and the zero are all still there, but in like a flattened way. We absolutely can do this, and this is how to move on. So I've said, I have not gotten any backlash from people in all of everything I've said. Very little, not any, you know, real backlash at all. There's some occasional people who are temporarily disturbed in some way that I can't quite hear properly or not understand, because that's not my purpose. I'm not here to trash anything. And people, I feel they can sort of tell that this is not a mean spirit here. This is an intelligent spirit. The there is a way that we can do this and move on by first honoring our creativity. And this is what I want. The situation in Egypt, by most people in America aren't aware. I mean, the Coptic Church was you know, you might call it the pretty much like the original church in Egypt, in Alexandria. Mark went down there, so the Apostolic See, Patriarchs of Alexandria. Mark established a church there. The evangelist Mark, not an apostle but an evangelist, and there's a thriving Christianity there, and then all the tremendous devotion of the desert fathers who became the monasticism in the desert in caves, and it's still going on today. Monasteries. There were so many monasteries, and so many caves and dwelling places in the desert, full of people practicing silence, practicing meditation, practicing prayer. Great spiritual practice there. And so Egypt was very Christian. Very, very Christian. You know, in some ways, you can include it in the cradle of Christianity. This is something that most of us don't realize. There's a vast heritage here, which ties into ancient history. The Greco-Roman Christianity is tied into Rome, is tied into Greece, it's tied into Egypt, actually. It's tied into all sorts of places. It's part of the fabric of our history, absolutely. It is this massive tapestry that's tied into to all of history, actually. In one way or the other. There's other traditions, tapestries also, that Hinduism can talk about his tapestry, Buddhism can talk about his tapestry, etc., etc. I'm focusing on the tapestry of Christianity. I could focus on the others, but I don't want to try to focus on all of them at this point. I'm focusing on Christianity. And it is, like I said, there was Christians in Egypt. Thomas went to Egypt. Persia, Iran, Afghanistan, or that whole area of the known world at that point, and the missionaries went to China too. Absolutely, they did. And it's Arabia, the whole Arabian Peninsula, Yemen, which the Queen of Sheba was down there, and over to Ethiopia and Somalia, that whole area, Nubia, the Upper Nile, Africa, the whole coast of Africa, Libya, Tunisia, Algeria, that area, Spain. I mean, it just spread. It's part of the tapestry of our history, and it's a tapestry of creativity, of great effort, of great perseverance, of great diligence, great longing, great hope, all this. And yet we were still believing that first we had to die, you know, before we could get any of the cookies, you know, we had to die authentically. And of course, by having this notion that we don't know anything about the afterlife, we can always presume that if you do the right rituals during the life of the body, when it dies, you go to heaven, you do get your happiness, right? We can presume that. But so they don't want anyone in this world who actually is aware of the afterlife and can see it, because then they say, oh, you know, maybe they're aware that maybe we don't get the true happiness after we die, and we that will ruin our belief system. So, I mean, that's another reason why people were so upset with me, is I could see the subtle life, the afterlife, the subtle life. I could see, you know, the beings in the subtler realms. And they said, no. You see, and I could say, well, such and such died, yeah, but they're not any happier than they were here in this life. They didn't, you know, dropping the body doesn't mean that you're stopping the idea of arrogance. The arrogance doesn't disappear. You just will just keep projecting on subtler forms, and then you eventually project on the body again. And they said, no. We believe if you took the Eucharist and believe in Jesus and the Creed, the Chalcedonian Creed, the Nicene Creed, then when you die, you're absolutely going to go to heaven, or at least you'll be in purgatory and then limbo and whatever. And so they don't want any evidence to the contrary. And they say, well, nobody can see, but we're just taking on faith. But if somebody can actually see, they don't like that. They say, no. That's disturbing to our faith. So by giving this new doctrine of accommodation, pretense, the theology of pretense and the doctrine of salvation through accommodation here, that now we're free to say, okay, yeah, and we can start seeing the subtler realms now, opening up to those two, afterlife realm, et cetera, and all the various symbols, subtler activity that's going on. We can do that now. So it really is opening up the door. It's opening up the door. And I was, you know, severely persecuted for my abilities when I came into the world. Severely. Because it threatened the belief that, you know, the authenticity of death, the belief that if they just die an authentic death, if I just keep eating this wafer that symbolizes the death of God, Jesus' flesh and blood, meaning that Jesus is definitely dead, I'm eating the wafer that reaffirms that God became flesh and God died, meaning I'm getting the authentic death now. And if I just take the Eucharist my whole life, that means that when I die, it will be an authentic death. And then I'll be resurrected as new life in heaven, but really as greater than God, is what our real belief, our aim is. So if you'd say, no, that doesn't happen at all. You know, just this, nothing happened. After you died, you're there, and you're in a subtler realm. And they said, no. That's counter to our whole teaching. So by moving on, it means that we're able to now allow for a expansion of our consciousness and awareness, and we do not have to apologize for that anymore. You see, this is very important. So we're going to let all this sink in. So you just have to give time for the wow of this, you know, the shock of this. Say, wow, somebody's actually saying this. I never thought it would happen. Yeah. Yeah. Well, you have to make it happen. I had to make it happen as far as working like a mule. Really. I mean, if you look at my life, you call me the mule. You know, I it's like, you know, the pack animals carrying super heavy pack loads through canyons and hot deserts and stuff every day of their life. Working myself to death almost. I really felt yesterday that I might die. I felt I might die. I said, I don't think I can go live another day. I'm finished. I'm just wiped out. And it's been like that my whole life. So, because this intensity of the fear here is so strong of, you know, believing that God must be really mad at us because we've almost succeeded in killing God. Yeah, I'm almost there. Now, almost isn't nowhere. It's like saying times like a 100 times zero. Say, well, we almost got it multiplied. We almost got it. It's like we almost done the impossible. No, there is no almost to the impossible. It's not like you can't get near to it. So we've never actually done anything. We've never done anything at all. Nothing's ever happened. We haven't gotten nearer to our goal at all. We haven't gotten close. We haven't gotten nearer. Whatsoever. So there's no causation for God that could give rise to God's wrath at all. How could there be? If we have done zero, how could there be causation? How can zero be causation? So if there's no causation, there can't be any effect. We can't just have an effect with no causation. So that's what we try to do. We just make this stuff out of thin air. You know, there's an effect without a causation. No, this is just an illusion, a mirage, a whim. Now we need to move fast. I'm having some interesting experiences in regard to this September. I'll tell you that. And I had one today that was just unsolicited entirely, and it was quite extraordinary. And someone relayed to me about how their house that they've been in 3 times in their life has been struck by lightning, and it all occurred on the exact same day on his birthday. And then he gave me the date of his birthday, and it was September 19th. And he was going on and on and on and on about this, you know, about this extraordinary. I mean, I said, that's so extraordinary. How could that happen? He says, yeah, well, it has. I said, well, you must be some kind of magnet for lightning. He says, yeah, I guess so. So we're told that an asteroid is going to strike the ocean in around September, you know, 20-something in the window of, you know, latish September. There's some that say that. I wouldn't be surprised at all if something like that happened, actually. And hopefully it's not. Maybe hopefully we can through whatever, you know, the dream, change the dream, as it were. But certainly there's been a pattern for me my entire life saying that something is going to there is going to be a lot of trouble here as we try to become authentically dead. We really try a lot of things here, actually. Spirit tries a lot. Spirit scripts a lot of creative acts, situations. And you just look at history of this world, how many creative situations Spirit has scripted. Spirit has dreamed all of it up. It's all Spirit's doing, scripting, trying to for Spirit to be authentically dead through all these different forms. The human form is just the latest form. Actually, this form has been around the universe in various different formats, but the spirit, you know, tries each form. Says, well, that doesn't quite work. I gotta evolve, quote unquote, script some more. Let's script some more. But let's but I can't actually make it seem like I did it. I have to make it, because then it wouldn't seem like I'm dead. So it has to evolve itself, you know. However, it's really scripting. You know, that's why there's a big conflict about, is evolution true or not? Or is it quote-unquote creationism? Well, it's neither. It's scripting. It's scriptism. And there's another way we can move on. It's scriptism. So we have accommodationism, theology of a pretensism, and now scriptism, where it is spirit scripting everything, actually, dreaming everything, but in a way that makes it seem as though spirit is dead and isn't doing it. This is why it's so perplexing to us. You know, people tearing their hair out and arguing with one another. We can flatten all that out too now. That's it. It's so all these different forms that appear, says, well, let's make something appear and we'll define it as alive. And then when it loses its and life comes in, that means that there's a death, authentic death has happened. And of course, it's all dreams, so it's not an authentic death. Spirit can't really authentically die. So then it keeps scripting new stuff and new stuff and new stuff. Let's try this. So it's a massive creativity. The whole history of this planet is just our massive creativity of scripting. Try this. And, the, you know, this latest, the human body is just, you know, one of the latest, you know, script. Things. Let's try this. Maybe the death of the body will be the answer. And where we can communicate and seem more like spirit, so the death of the body will seem more authentic. So we've scripted the human body in such a way that it seems quite spiritual, so that the death of the human body will seem more authentic spiritual death. This is why the human body is a place where spirit can kind of remember what it is and decide, make a decision like, hey, I am scripting. Because look at this. This is, I can see, you know, the scripting that I've put into this. It's becoming more obvious to me. So there's an opportunity for spirit when it's identifying with a body. There's a strong opportunity to recognize, oh, yeah, this is all pretensism and scriptism. And I can free myself through accommodationism and understanding accommodation, which is to flatten all past, flatten history, flatten all concepts, and yet still accommodate my desire to honor the creativity that I've been involved with. So these three tools basically enable us to set it all down and flatten it, let it all be flattened. Now, as we're experiencing it as flattened, our experience will seem to be, have the depth that we're experiencing will be a different type of feeling than the depth we're used to experiencing, which is all this ferment of time-space process in the form of waiting, of trying to have an authentic death. We're trying to get authentic depth within that. But it's not really authentic depth. It's an illusion of it. But when it's all flattened, then we'll feel authentic depth. So our feeling will be, call it bliss, call it authentic depth, authenticity. But it's not the authenticity of a body to die. It's not authentic death. It's authentic life, so to speak. So, back to that asteroid potentiality of or, you know, whatever comes. It seems to be this we're under this intense pressure to be able to move on here. Now, maybe if we're able to get this in ground us here, which has now happened, maybe we can say, you know, we don't need the asteroid, actually. We don't need it now. Okay? Because that's a terrible way of trying to flatten. That's not flattening, that's trashing. Okay? That's part of the whole script of trashing this world, which most here in this world are part of that script. They're here to see the world be trashed. Now, I say that's not necessary. That's not necessary at all. We don't trash it, we flatten it. Spiritually flatten it, as it were, mentally flatten it. So we don't really have to have an asteroid hit here. You know, we can script that out. We can say, no, it's not needed anymore. And as such, we could soften up the asteroid. Actually, the structure of it, because it's only a dream structure, it's just a dream symbol, to the extent that it disintegrates in the atmosphere, you know, and causes very little trouble, instead of like some big direct hit that, if it's really solid, that's very solidified, he'd come in, hit the Atlantic Ocean, and cause these terrible tsunamis and all this. But if we soften it up its structure, which we can, it's just a dream. It's just a dream figure. It's a figment of our own imagination, actually. If we soften up the structure, now, of course, we could make it disappear altogether, but then we would feel we're not honoring our creativity. There would be a lack of accommodation there. So there might be, some might say, hey, I need to have accommodation here. Okay, let's soften up the structure of the asteroid. So the density of the matter becomes much, much less dense and easily friable, breaks up into... which then they easily break up even more, and even break up even more, and then they burn up easily in the atmosphere, and maybe a few pieces, you know, plop 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 plop, whatever. It's not nearly as bad, you know. This is a possibility. Or we could just move its orbit a little bit, and move its trajectory, and it misses us, something like that, you know. These are all possibilities. But it is a possibility. The world, again, there's this strong desire to trash the past, to get free of the past without letting go of pretension, maintaining the desire to be authentically dead. It's just that we people thinking like, well, that didn't work, so let's bring in a new situation that works. This is a lot of the cosmic corporate culture here. They're, you know, they want to bring in something else and try that as authentic, be authentically dead. So they may very well want to, you know, trash this world severely, and bringing in an asteroid would certainly accomplish that in various ways. It would certainly start the process. We're told that there's going to be a tribulation period, and there's all sorts of calamities befall the world. Well, it's a trashing of the world. It's a trashing of the world, plain and simple. And I'm saying we don't have to do that at all. If this ideology is accepted here, everything can be just as it is. We don't have to do anything. But psychologically, we can see it as all flat, intrinsically flat, and has always been flat, actually. It was just an illusion that it had structure. So it was just an illusion it had dynamics. It was just an accommodation. We were simply accommodating our desire to act out this attempt to be greater than God. It was all just a pretension of accommodation. That's it. Or accommodation of retention, whatever way. And so we can just see it like that. And then nothing has to happen, and nothing has to be trashed. So this is the big question. What is going to happen soon? This is really the question, because there are those who want to trash this world. And we know that this is, you can see it in many, many ways. And there are others who don't want to trash it, actually. There's some that want to cling to the past. There's some that want to trash the past. And there's others who want to move on from the past, but without trashing it. You could say the liberals want to move on from the past and through trashing it. The conservatives want to hold on to the past. And those who have been listening to, you know, the right advice of the Holy Spirit and truth, voice of reason, want to move on from the past without trashing it, but by flattening it all in order to honor our creativity. So there's three basic camps right there. So the question is, what's going to happen? This is what I'm, you know, wow. We'll just have to let that sit for a while and recognize, okay. So those who want to move on and trash the past, and those who want to hold on to the past, they're going to be in a lot of conflict with one another, aren't they? And it could be a very vicious conflict. Whereas those who want to move on from the past, but by honoring the flattened out, flatten out and honor the flattened outness of the past and all concepts, judgments, etc., why should they be engaged in any sort of conflict? There's no conflict there. They're not in conflict with anyone. They're both moving on, and they're also honoring the past. So this is a third option, you see. Amazing day here. It's like autumn this morning. I swear, if I didn't know what day it was, I would have thought it was a late autumn day or something. It was amazing. A storm came through last night, tremendous thunder and rain. We don't have that happen in August here. So there's definitely El Nino's making its presence, sending its calling card here, for sure. Tropical storms, and then it was windy and cool this morning. And just wow, this is very unusual weather pattern we're experiencing, and they say a very strong El Nino is brewing. So I wouldn't be surprised if we get a lot of rain coming in, which is needed. It's amazing that all the trees have survived, you know, and everything survived here. Quite astonishing. Plants are real survivors, you know, amazing survivors. Which is, again, remember, all of this is part of our script, part of our creativity. All the plants, everything, that's part of our creativity of trying to find an authentic death. I said, maybe this will work. Maybe this will work. Let's try all this. Here's a whole category. Let's try this whole category. So much. So what would happen to this third group? What could we do? I don't know, but sidestep in some way. I've seen that I'm going to sidestep troubles in some way. I'm not, you know, really sure how. But somehow. Do our bodies really need to be dense? Like that asteroid, does it really need to be a dense body? Or can our bodies become much more diffuse? Is that possible? Sure. It just wouldn't seem so dead-like, you know? We're easy to recognize pretense from that. But since we've already accepted it's all a pretense, there's no reason why we can't do that. So, we'll find out. You can't really force this, but we're laying the groundwork, so to speak, opening the doors so that we'll find out. Maybe a student of Jesus will come along and explain it to us. We'll put it all together and say, oh, of course, we can do this. Some say the world will separate into two different worlds, something like that. That's possible. That is possible. One that where we just see it in a flattened out condition and appreciate it for a while before we move on, and the other world will try to, you know, trash the past, not flatten out, but trash it. And there'll be all sorts of terrible conflict there. There's a possibility. It feels like autumn today. It's just, what is it, August 7th? This is the earliest I think I've ever felt autumn here in California. August 7th. Usually autumn doesn't hit until, you know, October. It feels like summer throughout, you know, through a lot of October even. You can call it climate change. Yeah, I mean, there's change. I mean, climate alterations. But of course, there's always been changing climate. But that doesn't mean that this change in climate can't be have other factors involved in it. That too is possible. Anyway, much ado about very little. If what we think about trashing, ready to move on. There's no doubt that there's a huge segment of the population now, younger people, they want to move on, and they're willing to do whatever it takes. They're willing to trash the past. This is the feeling, the tone I get from the younger people, is they won't say it directly. Some do, actually. I've had some say it very directly. Actually, amazingly honest, that they're absolutely just going to destroy you. We're just going to wipe you out. We're going to wipe the past off the face of the map. Completely trash it. This is their goal. No doubt I've had them express this. But most won't say that directly, but they'll go along with it. They'll go along with it, just like the Nazi Germany. You know, not every but German directly expressed that they want to gas the Jews, and you know, but they went along with it. A lot of them. They didn't, you know, really insist on that it might not happen. They just said, "Well, we'll look the other way," and you know, so a lot of people here, they want to trash the past, but they don't want to admit it or be too directly involved. They say, but if someone, you know, they have others who are willing to be activists and that, they just kind of look the other way and pretend that they didn't really know what was happening. You know, it's like the POTUS. You know, all this stuff happened. They said, "Well, I didn't really know. I didn't know that. I wasn't aware of that." And just looking the other way. You know, foments all this stuff and then looks the other way. Says, "Well, oh, no, I wasn't aware of that. I wasn't really involved in that. I can't blame me for that." You know, he's setting a tone. This is why the POTUS, present one, became present, is because so many people in this world, they like that. He was showing that this is how you can do it. This is how you can trash the world, but pretend that you're innocent of trashing the world, basically. This is how you can destroy civilization, trash the past, and say, "Well, I didn't really know, you know, about what was going on, and I was just doing good, and you know, no." And this is why his psychology is exactly that, and this is why he was elected, because great many young people here, that's their goal, is to trash the past, actually. And he's an expert trasher and pretender that he's, you know, "I didn't do anything wrong. Oh, no, not me. You know, I'm not responsible for all this," you know, fomenting all this, you know, agitation and division and stuff, and then saying, "What? You know, no, that's something, all that stuff happened, you know, the all these scandals, like, I didn't even know about it. I didn't know anything about this. You know, I don't know anything about this, you know." Of course, yeah, of course, sure, right. But he's very good at just being above it all, at the same hand, has his hand fomenting all this stuff. And this is what people want. This is what people want. You want to know why this guy is in the White House, for instance? It's because this is what people want. They want someone who can show them the way, who can idealize this and say, an expert at it, which he's an expert at. He is an expert. Absolute expert at this. And this is what they want. This is what they say. They're learning from it. Okay, this is how we do it. Yeah, and they're practicing it. They're learning and practicing. We can trash this. We can trash this. We can trash this. But we can then seem like we're just all above it. And like, no. I didn't know anything about any of this stuff. But time to move on now. And then throw all this positive vibe thing. Yeah, let's honor this. Let's honor this. And sweep it all under the rug. You know, this is what they want. This is what they want. This is what they voted for. So now another mystery of history has just been resolved here. A big one, right? A very big one. People wondering, what in the world is going on? I mean, those who are getting trashed are saying, hey, we're getting trashed. And of course, those who are doing the trashing are just like, what are you talking about? What war on religion? You're crazy. There's no war on religion. You guys are just wing nuts, nut jobs. You know, we're not doing anything. You know, it's hilarious. I mean, as far as the whole pretense and farce, you know, that's going on, is they're trying to trash everything they can possibly trash about, you know, and pretending that no, we're not doing anything. None of that. What are you talking about? You're crazy. They create a bunch of crazies coming out. This is what's going on. Anyone who complains about getting trashed, you know, is a crazy. Oh yeah, the crazies are talking again. You know. So the POTUS is an expert at this attitude and this tone and the whole cleverness of trashing. And then just rationalizing to yourself that, hey, it's all okay. I didn't really know about any of this anyway, really. And you know, but I just set the tone for everybody else so they would know what to do. And then doing it, but I didn't really know. You know, it's like that. So yeah, hold on a minute. Yeah. This enables us to move on, doesn't it? We say, oh, so this is the mystery resolved. Yeah, wow. Wow. You can see it from a third perspective, right? You're not in either of these camps. When you're not in either one of these camps, like let's move on by trashing the past or let's keep the past, then you can look at it from a different perspective and say, oh my gosh, so this is the dynamic that's taking place there. And this is why those who are being trashed are so furious, and those doing the trashing are pretending like, we're not doing anything. You guys are just making all this up. You're crazy. You know, anyone who complains about you're trashing our culture, you're trashing our heritage, you're trashing our values, you're trashing our traditions. They say, well, a bunch of crazies. There's some kind of war on women. They're trying to, you know, they have women do the trashing, and then when they complain, they say, you guys are instituting a war on women here. You know, they're terrible people. You know, my gosh, not even worth. You know, you should be ashamed of yourself trying to trash women like that. And let's move on. Time to move on. You know, these guys are just crazy. This is their whole spiel, their whole shtick. And they're learning from the master trasher himself, you know, in the White House. That's why he's the leader of it. And they get their cues from him. Oh, this is, they get their playbook, their script. And they have their lines. They know exactly what to say. Oh, okay. Someone said that. Someone's complaining about being trashed. Okay, when you say, I'll say this line here, you know, blah, 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 blah. You're a bigot. You know, what a bigot. What a racist or something. Wow, that's racism, that's all. Oh, my God. You know, they're crushing all the traditions of thousands of years. And people are saying, oh, my God, this is hideous. You're destroying our whole being and existence. And they said, oh, bunch of racists, you know. Pathetic, sad, really sad. They get what they deserve by being such terrible racists or bigots or whatever, right? So they rationalize it to themselves. Say, well, they're just getting what they deserve because they're terrible people, that's all. And meanwhile, all these wonderful people, you know, are getting absolutely crushed. And they're screaming and saying, "My God, what's going on? This is just hideous, 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 hideous." And eventually they get into the Stockholm syndrome of, you know, emulating their trashers, worshiping their trashers, saying, "Oh, yeah, that's so wonderful. You're trashing us." And you end up identifying it, you know. But we're not involved in that at all, because we have a better way. Jesus has a better way. Now, I found that those who are getting trashed, they don't seem to really be able to pick up on this so well. Neither are those who are doing the trashing. They can't pick up on it either. They're both very, very into what's going on and unable to get this perspective of the real teachings of Jesus. How do we move on without trashing? This is the question. How do we truly move on? Not just institute some other way of trying to be authentically dead, but truly move on from this entire pretense altogether. How do we do that? This is what Jesus is here to tell us. So this is a way better perspective. It's a different perspective. People just aren't aware of it, really. They're not really aware of it. Some are, you know, more so than others. There's some that are, yeah, I kind of feel that there is this different perspective. And we're working to focus it. That's all. Get it more and more focused so we start saying, "Oh wow, we can even see through the trasher in the White House." Absolutely, the chief trasher, the expert trasher, who's, you know, I have a, you know, a Harvard professorial tone, speaking like your professor and very intellectual, and how could I be doing any trashing? That's just ridiculous to even think about that. You know, these people are just, you know, they're silly. They're silly. It's all just being silly again. I was listening to the radio and I heard the POTUS come on and start talking about, and I felt this immediate revulsion, you know, like I just want to throw up. I just turned it off. I said, "Wow, just the tone, just the whole attitude and tone, regardless of what he's saying." I just said, "Wow, I cannot listen to that voice anymore. It just, no way." No, it is just the voice of trashing, you know. Wow, very trashy tone, condescending, supercilious, arrogant, you know, and dismissive and lecturing and all this kind of stuff. Oh, yuck, 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 yuck. It's no. Oh, it gives me the creeps just thinking about it. But, you know, it is what it is. It is what it is. This whole farce is what it is. And those, of course, are defending the past, are defending a side trip. But what they're really, you know, there's several things. What they're afraid of the wrath of God, which doesn't exist. And they're afraid they won't be able to honor their creativity. So what I'm saying is, guess what? Good, there is no wrath of God, so don't worry about that. And yes, let's honor our creativity. Let's honor the side trip. Flatten it out, but keep it in that flattened out condition so we can honor it. But not trashed, but psychologically, mentally flattened out. And so it's one of love and appreciation and forgiveness instead of being attacked and battling and all this kind of stuff. So it's the right way to sidestep this madness that's coming, where you have this trasher in chief who, you know, is pushing forward this agenda as fast as possible in every conceivable way, and doing things that people are just astonished. It's like, what are you doing? I mean, this is going to cause ruination. It's going to cause trashing of so much. And he says, if you don't agree with this, you know, you are very terrible, incredibly terrible people. It says, what? What are you talking about? You know, well, you don't like this, that's okay. I'll just make an executive order, and that's the way it is. You know, what? What about the Constitution? Well, you know, only terrible people will cling to their Constitution, you know. And so it's like, what? And it's like, it's just on and on and on and on and on. What? Are you got to be kidding me. You've got to be kidding me. And then you get someone who's a defender of the past, the faith, like a Trump. Defender, here's the hero. You know, Trump's the hero. Says, hey, I won't let this trashing continue. No way. I won't let anyone trash me. And he doesn't, you see. And basically, so he's like saying, you know, hey, look, you know, you don't have to be trashed. And people try to trash him constantly. I saw some of the debate last night after taping. And my God, they were out to kill him, you know. And he wouldn't let him. He wouldn't let himself be trashed. And this is what people like. This is what those who are trying to hold on to the past, they say, wow, hey, maybe we don't have to be trashed. You know, that's what they're feeling. You know, and even the skirt there tried to, you know, she's the main one who tried to really get him. The other guys, a guy did too. And he wouldn't let it happen. And he said, hey, if people are just absolutely trying to trash me constantly, I don't have time to, I frankly don't have time to be totally politically correct. It's not the time for it, you know? This is like a very good answer. In other words, you know, you try to trash me. I don't have the time for niceties here. You're trying to trash me. So I'm gonna fight back. I'm not going to let you do that. And you're crying and squirming about, well, you didn't say it. You're not politically correct. You're not totally politically correct. We have zero tolerance for anyone who's not politically correct. How awful, you know. The skirt was all, oh, you're making me feel so uncomfortable here. You know, mean to me. Don't be mean. I'm trying to trash you in a nice way, and you're fighting back. That's not right, you know. And he says, well, look, I have time to be perfectly, totally correct, you know. So stop trying to trash me, and I won't be, you know, hit back. And so people hear this, of course they're going, those are being trashed, the target of all the trashing, of course they're going to, that's like manna from heaven to them. And then of course the ones doing the trashing are just saying like, oh, what an idiot, what a fool, he just fell on his face, he's finished, he's over, that's done with, you know, obviously he's a complete idiot, get out of the way, he's, you know, they're just desperate to get rid of this guy. Because he is like a hero to those who are being trashed. Because personally, he doesn't allow himself to be trashed. More so than like anyone we've had on the stage in recent memory, actually. I don't know if anyone can quite... It's astonishment, you know. You should come up with Trumpisms of what he said, you know, says. And people are trying to trash him. He just says, hey, we're done here. That's it. You know, reporters trying to trash him. And he just says, hey, you know, we're done here. That's it. We're finished here. He says, no, I'm not going to sit here. I'm not going to let you lecture me and trash me and stuff. No way, I'm not going to let it do it. And he pushes back to the news reporters who are, you know, the trasher in chiefs. And they found out that the skirts can do it better than the trousers, because they can always claim, oh, you're being mean to me. You're being unfair. You're making me feel uncomfortable. You're not protecting me as a woman. You know, you're not a gentleman. You're so, you know. So it's much harder to fight back against a woman than as a man. So women can get a lot more trashing done than men can, actually. And that's why the skirts are in charge right now. They're in charge in so many ways. It's hardly unbelievable. More and more and more, you realize, oh, the chief negotiator was a skirt. You know, UN ambassador, yeah, a skirt. You know, Secretary of State was a skirt. Was Clinton, you know. They're putting all these chief positions because, you know, you can't, as a man, you cannot, even as a woman, you cannot really, you know, trash back at them, push back at them, because then they can then, you know, they have a set, different set of rules. Say, hey, wait a minute, you know, we can't have the same rules for men and women. That's not fair. And then they say, well, you have to play by my rules. You can't, you know, so I can trash you, but you can't come back at me and trash me. They say, basically, and they say, well, you're mean to me. You're threatening me. You have a war against women here. This is how they're doing it. This is how they're doing it. And Trump doesn't care. He's like the one guy who will push back at a woman. You know, she tries to, you know, cut out, you know, kill him, and basically, I mean, his reputation and ruin him. And he says, hey, you know, why are you being so mean to me? You know, I don't have time to be politically correct and just, you feel uncomfortable. Well, tough. I'm too busy to, you know, who cares about the tone? People are getting their heads cut off. Who cares about the tone? Why are you so concerned about the tone? That's ridiculous. Yeah, and he's got a point, right? I mean, there's all this terrible trashing going on. He says, and you're whining about some tone, you know? How, you know, that's just, you know, pathetic. And so he's like the only person really on the stage that still is able to speak this way. Most everybody else has been severely cowed. So they're out in the most vigorous way to destroy him. So their trashing is unimpeded. They want unimpeded trashing. You know, they're on a rampage, pillaging. I mean, they're the barbarians sacking Rome, and they want to absolutely sack the past completely. They're just getting started. They're sharpening their knives right now. And suddenly this Trump jumps on the stage and they say, what the heck? You know, now they've turned the knives on him. and ridiculously attacks on him. And so anyway, this is the drama that's going on here in the U.S., United States. And it's symbolic of the drama going around the world that I've spoken to people from other places around the world. You know, for like Australia, I mean, it's more PC there than anywhere, right? I mean, they're getting crushed in Australia, Sweden, you know, wherever you go, they say, we can't say a thing. They say, we can't say a thing about the trashing of our culture and what's going on, or we will be decimated by the media and the social media and the activists and all that kind of stuff, the trashers. And the trasher in chief of the whole planet is the guy in the White House right now, actually, who sets the tone for all these countries. Say, yeah, this is how we do it. This is how we do it. You know, if I do a rap song about that, this is how we do it. And so there's this model of how to do it with using the media and social, and then the social media. And changing the laws, all this stuff, the progressives, you know, they're expert trashers of the past. Now, but they're very vindictive, very unforgiving, very vindictive, very angry. They don't know how to do it at all. They're ignorant, completely ignorant, and very destructive. So, but Jesus is completely different than that. So, it's good that someone who is a student of Jesus is saying this, because it's a different tone than you're getting at other places. So I have, reverence and respect and honor and love and for all of the creativity, everything we've done in the past, in all its, insane majesty. And there is a way just to flatten it all out. Our whole conceptual structure can just be completely flattened out. And it is true that those who are trying to trash the past and those who are trying to protect the past will maybe so engaged like a dogfight with one another that they're completely oblivious to the third this other option here. Like completely unaware of it. I mean, they talk about Jesus, they say, well, Philo of Alexandria was present at the whole time of Jesus, and he didn't know anything about Jesus, so it must be a myth. You know, well, I mean, Philo was so involved in what he was doing, trying to prove that all truth came from Moses, that, he wouldn't have even noticed Jesus. And the option that Jesus brought was not on his radar at all. Now, is for instance, is Trump a nice guy? Well, if you don't try to trash him, he is. But if you try to trash him, he's not a nice guy at all. He'll hit back 100 times harder. I mean, he'll hit back. So, it's a loaded question. Is he a nice guy? Yeah, I mean, if you play golf with him, everyone who's talked to him say he's a good guy. He's an honest guy. He's a straightforward guy. He's not some devious, slimy trasher type of guy. But if you try and destroy him, he's going to try to destroy you. That kind of situation. Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. So people who want to fight to preserve tradition, of course they love him, absolutely. Why wouldn't they? So we don't want to destroy tradition here. We want to honor it. Because it was a side trip, we understand that, so we're going to move on. We're not bodies. We've never been a body. I've never been a body. I've always been free. I've always been exactly spirit, exactly as God created me. Always been spirit, exactly as God created me. So we want to move on to, instead of pretending to be dead, we want to set that aside. That's enough of pretending to be dead. That's not what really God created us for, to pretend to be not created by God. God didn't create life for life to pretend to be dead. You know, but we're free to do that, but that's not really, you know, the full purpose of what we're created for. So we do want to move on, but with love and forgiveness and honoring our creativity as the essential precondition of moving on. So I absolutely insist upon this. And those who, you know, in moving on, the people will automatically assume, well, you must have trashed the past. How else could you move on? This is false. This is ignorant. It's ignorant. And this is why I've been blocked from moving on in my life. Moving on is because people will reason from a false premise, saying, well, how did you move on? You must have just hate the past and trashed it, so you really can't feel loving. And no, I'm honoring the past. It's still here is a flattened way. So we do have the tools, we do have the clarity now to recognize our options. I've often said that this president's the last president, the pope's the last pope. And I just think, how is that possible? Well, I mean, there's one possibility. The people are saying this president is not going to step down, actually. It's going to continue. But we say, well, how's that possible? And they're really worried about him changing the Constitution or doing something. You can't put anything past him, actually. He says, my trashing work is not finished yet. I got to keep at it here. What are you talking about? So, but that might cause too much of a reaction. But if an asteroid did hit in the ocean and tsunami on the east coast of the United States this would cause martial law in the United States. There'd be refugees flooding the Southwest, which is what indications are that I've gotten is of refugees in the Southwest United States. Even before I was aware of this asteroid situation, I felt there's going to be a huge problem in the Southwest United States. Why? Well, they would be fleeing the East Coast, for sure. Fleeing the East Coast. And there would be so much chaos that they would have to install martial law, and they'd have to suspend the election. The president would just executive order to say that due to martial law and the powers that are now, and I mean, he's an expert in just ignoring the Constitution and making any sort of executive decrees he wants to, and paying no attention when anyone else says about it. So he would just say, I'm just suspending the election and we'll push it forward into appropriate time. Meanwhile, I'm going to stay here in power and we're going to have martial law and we're going to, you know, this is something that could easily happen. Now, if the asteroid did not cause the problem, and we're able to disintegrate it somehow, then there wouldn't be this pretext for martial law, would there? Kind of interrupt the plans of destructivity. But there's a lot of moderates, actually, who are still on the fence. So if they, you know, if they could just hear this and say, wait a minute, we have another option here. We can let go of the past by honoring our creativity, by flattening the past. And this is what Jesus is here to help us with. So they say, okay, we don't need to go so far as martial law and keep the destructor in chief in place and stuff. We can move on from that too. You know, that's also something we need to move on, is the trashing of the past. We need to move on from that too. We shouldn't be trashing anything we do, actually. We can move on from it, but by honoring it, we don't have to trash it. So hopefully Jesus' presence here is going to bring about this moderation of the whole situation, actually. I've heard people like our Democrats, they say, yeah, I really agree with everything Trump's saying, you know, but I just can't vote for him. Like, why? They say, why? Well, I'm a Democrat. I just can't. But they're moderate. See, actually, Democrats, there was a time when they were, a lot of them were actually moderates. I identified as a Democrat, is moderate. You know, I said, let's move on, but we're not trashing the past. Let's see if we can find a way to move on without trashing the past. So it's moderate. But it got taken over, usurped, taken over, in other words can be used, right? Commandeered, et cetera, by the radical trashers. And so a lot of Democrats are saying, wow, I can't really agree with a lot of this stuff, but I just can't vote for Republicans. It's impossible. I can't do it. It's impossible. People say, well, you know, why not? I mean, so maybe there's some moderates who can say, you know what, hey, I'm looking for another way. I'm looking for another way. They're just like a lot of Catholics are looking for another way. They don't want to trash the church, but they're saying, well, you know, it's time to move on from this. This was a side trip. And Christians in general, people from all religious faiths say, you know what, it's time to move on. I feel like this has been like a side trip. But I don't want to trash it. I don't want to trash it. So there's this really huge body of people in the world who are more moderate. And there's this small group who are super radicals, and then there's also this fairly large group of traditionalists. Okay, actually the radicals are well, now with the younger generation, young people tend to be naturally want to move on from the past, and they've exploited these young people to an extraordinary extent, and promised them a hedonistic paradise if they can just help trash the past. You know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Hey, we'll have a really hedonistic paradise for you kids. The kids say, wow, you know, what a groovy destructor in chief we got here. And so they've got that going for them, along with a lot of other ways that they've promised people a utopia if they just support them. So they do have a lot of support, but the support is kind of, if people start seeing what's going on, they're going to say, wow, you know, I don't really want that. So there's a small, hardcore of super radicals activists, and then they've managed to hoodwink a lot of moderates. But some of the moderates are waking up for that and saying, whoa, wait a minute here. Not everyone leaves the church, you know, is attacks it necessarily, you know, right? They say, well, we still respect what the church stands for, and we understand, we honor it, instead of we just not going along with it, especially when this present pope, they're saying, whoa, wait a minute. That's not the church I want. he's another Mariologist that, you know, it's amazing. Which means that what they really mean is that God became flesh and suffered. And died, literally died. And they have to venerate Mary in order to believe this. This is really what it is. They hope that through their veneration of Mary that they make it true. This is why there's so much veneration of Mary. They're saying basically, Mother Mary, please, 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 make it true that God did become flesh and died. Please, please, please. You have the power. If I venerate you, then you will, I'll make you authentic, and you'll have the ability to actually bring this about, you know. So they're, that's why they venerate Mary. Now, the real Mary would be appalled at this, you know. Is like, what are you talking about? This is crazy. At least you would think so, right? And there's no early evidence for any of that veneration, or Jesus venerating his mother, anything like that. Absolutely not. This is all built in later, so that we could, you know, to support the notion of God becoming flesh, God suffering, and then God actually dying, which is what we're, you know, God the Son, Spirit, dying here, which is what we're trying to do. We're trying to find an authentic death. And so in order to believe that God the Son became flesh, they have to venerate the Virgin Mary and say that she's the mother of God. And they think that through the veneration of her, it will actually somehow magically make what they wish be true. So this is what's going on. That's all what's going on. Now, the council in Ephesus, where, what, the second, was it 431 or something like that? they chose that place because that was at that time that they say that's where Mary lived when she, you know, left Jerusalem, left, and when she moved to Ephesus. And they actually have a house was there that showed this is the house that she lived in, and so they actually held this council in the house that Mary is supposed to have lived in. And there was huge veneration of Mary in Ephesus. Yeah, the cult of Mary, and before they had worshipped Artemis or Diana, the cult of the goddess Artemis, and so there was a very strong goddess worshiping cult in Ephesus from Greco Rome through Roman times, and that then got projected onto Mary, and so they held the council there where they declared that Mary was the mother of God. Because the people, the whole atmosphere and the whole people there say, yeah, sure, no problem, we're fine with that. And of course they did that before all those who from Antioch who said no, before they could even arrive there. They concluded all this before they even arrived. And when the people who got there arrived, they said, hey, wait a minute, what'd you do? We didn't get to vote. And they said, well, you're too late. You didn't get here in time. this is how it was decided upon. And then they held a sudden, the ones who were late, from Antioch, the Antiochians said, wait a minute, we'll hold our own council. And they denounced Cyril of Alexandria and as a heretic and banished him, and as they had been banished. And then the Roman Empire actually sided with them, you know, the Roman Emperor declared that Cyril of Alexandria was the heretic, and he had to flee. He had to flee actually back to Alexandria and go into hiding. And so what he did was he then bribed the courtiers of the emperor, who then hired thugs who then threatened the emperor with death. And the emperor was so scared that he relented and said, no, guess what? Cyril's, Mary is the mother of God. Cyril is right. It's, you know, the Nestorians who are heretics, and we're going to decide Mary is the mother of God. Just to save his life, you know, from the thugs that had been paid by the courtiers who had been bribed by Cyril of Alexandria. So this is how, you know, this stuff, you know, came about. But there is a theological, Christological reason for insisting upon Mary being the mother of God. Otherwise, you know, if Mary isn't the mother of God, then she was just a mother of what? Of a man? And if just a mother of the man, then how do we explain, you know, why the man suffering and dying would be fulfilling our script, what we want? You know, so this is a big problem. And they have to bring Arianism or adoptionism into it and say, well, God just adopted Jesus, the man. But say, no, that doesn't quite do it yet. So they, in order to get that God became flesh, they had to venerate Mary. Because they said, well, if God became flesh, Mary gave birth to God. So she must have, how did she do that? Well, she must have been special. Super special. But again, they're actually venerating it as if that this is magically going to make it true that God became flesh. But this is just, you know, utter mental self-deception and delusion. Huh. Some sort of puffball, white puffball from some plant just floated down right in front of me there and just hung in the air, being hit by the light, the sun, and it's just all this brilliant, soft white, and then it just floated up into the sky. So we can forgive all that, too. You say, oh, okay, I mean, in order to try to get the accommodation that you were demanding, then you're stuck. You say, wait a minute, you know, how do we, if Mary is just a regular woman, and How is this possible? That doesn't seem to have the juice we need. You know, we better change that. I mean, Jesus said to John, take care of my mom, you know, I'm gone. I mean, if Mary was the mother of God, knows this, you know, equal to God in Jesus, so why would she need to be taken care of, you know? It doesn't make any sense at all. This is just Jesus being, you know, the good accommodator, saying, hey, you know, my mom is, you know, she's just like, you know, struggling just like the rest of you, and take care of her. She needs some help here. Take care of her. So John took her to Ephesus, where the Apostle John is said to have lived and written, you know, what he wrote, the letters of John, I believe. And the John of Patmos is, I believe, a different John did the book of Revelations. Patmos being an island just, you know, 30 miles off the shore, near Ephesus there, which is on the coast. It was a harbor. Very powerful city, maybe as many as a couple, 200,000 people maybe. One of Rome's primary cities. I mean the Roman Empire, Rome, Ephesus, and then Asia Minor is a very, very, there's one other there. One of the three major Roman cities. Antioch was a Grecian city. But Ephesus had been, you know, changed hands a lot and was more Roman at that time, actually. In fact, during one of the wars from the Persians and various kings that they came in and slaughtered all the Romans, anyone who spoke with a Latin accent was killed. So Ephesus was heavily Roman. And we get a lot of the creeds and things, you know, a lot of decisions were made there as to how are we going to stitch this all together. You know, what a mess. They said it just doesn't quite fit. You know, that's the thing, they're like tearing their hair out, saying we got this, but you know, how do we fit it all together? It just doesn't quite fit. And then you say, we can stitch this one here and stitch this and all, but that doesn't quite fit there, and then this doesn't quite fit there. And so it's just, they were like tortured by it. They're just struggling, because they had the wrong premises. Premi. I don't know if that's a word. Haven't heard it. Premises. Do you say premises or premi? So we just give this time to sink in. We're talking about something that is extraordinary here. New declaration, basically a complete summation of all history, all ideology, and certainly Christology. And, you know, once we get that, it's easy enough to move on. But we flatten it all out first, without trying to struggle with all the details of that. Getting the big picture here. So there's a wow, big wow to this, and very, it's like we feel like we're getting flattened. I felt very flattened yesterday. I felt so flattened. I said, my gosh. But that's because I'm still holding on, you know, to some aspect of the dynamic of what I'm trying to flatten here. So you can feel like you're getting flattened by this, which is why you have to take the full stop and the wow, the glass is half full stance. When you do that, the glass is half full, you don't feel so flattened. Even though you know there's all this flattening going on, you say, well, there's something that isn't being flattened. The glass is half full here, and I know it's going to get fuller, so I'll just maintain this positive attitude. And as this stress of it's going on, I feel like I'm being flattened, but I know it's not really me that's being flattened. This is the glass half full. If you go the glass half empty route, you're going to feel like you're being flattened, and you say, oh my God, this is horrible, I'm dying, I want to kill myself, I just can't stand this, this is awful. And you can't do it that way. You cannot do it with a glass half empty attitude. So that's what I had to do. I had to keep saying, no, this, it'll be okay, I'll bounce back, and this is great, this is a wow, this is a huge wow, and let me just, I had to use that, I had to use it. Otherwise, I would have become despondent, for sure. There already were traces of despondency creeping in, and I just had to use this technique. What I'm saying is the right technique, full stop on the wow. I'm experiencing a very intense shock of making so much success and progress. And so let me just see it as glass half full. I know that this shock will wear off, and I know when it does wear off, I'll be way further along, which is exactly what's happened. So there does have to be this willful choice to see it as glass half full. It's a willful choice, because you could see it either way if you want to. I mean, you can interpret it that it's half empty also if you want to. And say, oh my gosh, my glass is being emptied out. Well, there is flattening going on, but the flattening is actually the filling of the glass, because it's we're getting what we really want. So our glass is being filled up, and then the other, you know, it's not really being, as we empty the glass, it's really being filled up. Empty the glass of the past by flattening it. We're actually filling up the glass of getting what we really want, by maintaining our honoring of our creativity, and also then moving on to. So again, one has to see it. Oh, the glass is half full. Is half full. As I'm emptying the glass, it's really being filled up. And as we're emptying it, we're seeing, wow, no matter what I do, it's still half full. Still half full. How is that possible? And we can interpret that two ways. Like, oh my, it's ready to be emptied, or no, it's ready to be filled up. So as we're emptying of the past, we're also filling it up with the good news that we're able to move on. So the glass sort of stays like half empty like that. So we're under the gun right now in terms of the world. I mean, the polarization between those who want to trash the past and those who want to preserve it is, you know, getting very, very extreme. For example, after the debate, you had this poll taken on a website, a very popular website, of who won the debate. I mean, how well did people do who won the debate? And you know, Trump got over 40%. And nobody else was even close. You know, somebody got maybe 10% or whatever. 40%. People thought he won it. And but if you listen to the analysts after the debate, they're on there, you know, pontificating that just like complete disaster for Trump. He's finished. This is the beginning of the end. People can see he's a complete buffoon. Doesn't know what he's doing. You know. And so you have these spin doctors from the side who want to trash the past, who are just elated, saying, my God, it's so obvious this guy's a complete buffoon. Anyone could have seen that. This is the end of him. And whereas you get on this other site, where you got, you know, 40% saying that he absolutely, you know, won the debate, and then all the other 10 candidates is divided, you know, the rest is divided among them, but 40%, that's a huge number, you know, huge number. So there's a complete disconnect between the two sides. Complete disconnect. The one side says he's just, for their eyes, he's just an absolute buffoon. What a clown. A clown, a joke, a buffoon. And he's certain to just collapse any day. And the other side is saying he's the greatest hero. Fantastic. What a great American. What a great hero. And he's not going to collapse at all. So you have these, you know, ships in the night, absolutely, with a completely different narrative and a completely different set of expectations as to what's going to happen. And when you have that kind of situation, that is volatile, very volatile. And, you know, it's ripe to be exploited, and it certainly will be in various ways. And so we get a very intense, inflammable situation right now. It's like the Hindenburg. Holy Spirit had me check out the Hindenburg recently. I don't know why. I actually saw a photo. It was some photo highlighted on the internet of the cabin on the Hindenburg, luxury. It said luxury on the Hindenburg. And I looked at it. I was interested. And they had all these swank, you know, dining areas and lounges and everything. And it's like, wow, it's really bizarre. And then, you know, you start looking into the Hindenburg, and what, it had 9 tons of hydrogen gas, highly flammable hydrogen gas. Then, of course, a spark, you know, set it off. Some say it sparks, some say sabotage, but whatever, a spark, you know, whatever what caused a spark set off the hydrogen gas, and kaboom, you know, and the whole thing burned to ground. Well, we think, well, gosh, everybody died. No, I think like 37 people died in, you know, was it 90, 60 or 90, whatever. Majority of people didn't die. They didn't perish. It was pretty surprising. They managed to get out somehow. Interesting, huh? So this is good news. Jesus has good news to give us. He has options. There's some option that Jesus knows about, that he's cluing us into it. People think that Trump is going to be like the Hindenburg. He's just going to explode. They're desperately looking for that button, the explode button, to spark. They're trying to spark him to just have a complete ranting meltdown. You know, this is what they're after. And then, you know, then people say, we can't trust him with his finger on the nuclear button. Are you kidding me? This guy's a maniac. But I'll tell you what, somebody who's willing to display their emotions in public in an honest way is less dangerous than somebody who nurses them in private and presents a smooth, sophisticated facade to the public, you know. They're the ones that can get away with a lot, whereas the ones that just, you know, are up forward and honest, hey, I'm really upset with what you said, you're really mean to me, I didn't like it, really, you know. Then, you know, a couple minutes later, it's like, hey, okay, moving on from it. Maybe there'll be a lawsuit, maybe not, but, you know, it's finished as far as, you know, emotions and everything like that. Yeah. So, but the idea of making it seem like a irrational, volatile, you know, temper tantrum kind of person is that's what they're trying to get at. So they keep pushing, keep finding where's the button. You know, maybe they'll be attacking the wives next or the children or, you know, who knows what. They've tried a lot already, and nothing has worked so far. And I guarantee you, they have experts in this who are right now strategizing of, you know, what buttons to push. Literally. Absolutely are. There are experts in button pushing. And they're doing, you know, profiles and psychological profiles. And it's like, okay, if we just, you know, push, okay, so let's try this one and combination maybe in there. They're looking for it. And then they pass that on to the news organizations in clever ways. They float these ideas like, you know, what if somebody said, or a story, somebody dug up this story. Oh, hey, look, hey, reporter, I came across this. What about me? Think, oh, my gosh, there's a story. Yeah, it's a story. Why don't you tell a story? And then it's in headlines, you know. Hey, you know, this. You know, and then they're looking for buttons to push. This is how dirty politics is, really. Same thing with any politician, you know, they try to do that, right? The opposition tries to do that, push their buttons. So, the Hindenburg, they hope that he's going to be the Hindenburg and just completely explode. But it may be the whole situation that is full of hydrogen gas. You might say that the world is like a blimp that's full of hydrogen gas right now. And people are absolutely teed off and they don't understand it. The ones who are trashing cannot understand at all. That why the ones who are being trashed could be angry or upset in the slightest bit, because as far as they're concerned, they're not doing anything. They're not trashing anyone. No. There's no war against religion or, you know, war against traditional values. What are you talking about? Angry? Why are you angry? You must be irrational. There's nothing to be angry about. It's like, wow, you're really dangerously irrational. It's just, you know, this is what they do. This is their tricks. So, but, you know, there are many people are very angry. And, of course, the others are just completely disconnected. No, nothing to be angry about. So you don't have angry people. You got a bunch of people who are sick, wacko, mentally sick, wacko, irrational wackos who get angry over nothing. Crazy. Oh, yeah, we just redefined the definition of marriage that for the entire history of the planet. It's been defined this way. We just say, well, let's just change it. It's no big deal. Time to move on from the past, you know. And people are angry. Well, what are they angry about? I mean, this is just what's righteous and just and good and so obvious. I mean, there's nothing to be angry about. It's ridiculous. It must be irrational. It must be mentally unstable. You need therapy. You need drugs. We've got pharmaceuticals. Companies will supply you with all the drugs you need. We're compassionate people. We have drugs for you. So, you're saying that we're very compassionate people. We're just helping you, you know. And this is, makes the people even more angry. Like, don't patronize us and deny what you're doing. And this is disconnect. Those who are doing the trashing keep pretending they haven't done anything wrong. And so there couldn't possibly be any rational anger towards them in the slightest bit. Any anger towards them at all is completely irrational. And then the church said, well, how do I figure that out? And then they put the women in charge and they say, well, obviously, you don't like women, that's why. See, they can explain it away that way. You know, you're just irrational. They don't want to get in a confrontation where they say, well, you just, you know, it's obvious, you know, it's a war against women, you don't like women. And that's why you're so angry, you know. Oh, okay, now we understand, now we got it. It's not because we're destroying all your values and traditions, etc. It's just you don't like women, that's all. That's their playbook. They have this playbook, you know, that they're following. And it's a very devious Machiavellian playbook. Maybe the POTUS is Machiavelli himself, you know. Or maybe the mentor of Machiavelli. And this just gets people even more angry. Wait a minute, you mean you're trashing me and then you're claiming that I have no right to be angry, that there's nothing to be angry about, I'm just misogynist, you know, like, this is insane. No, I'm angry because you're trashing this and my values and this. And you're claiming that no, you're not doing any of that, and my anger then is irrational, and the only option I have basically they give two options. They say, one, you're either mentally sick, a very dangerous mentally ill character, and you need heavy drugs, or the other option is that you're just misogynist, okay, or homophobic, misogynist, racist, bigot, whatever. But basically, they think the best one's misogynist. You just have a war against women. That's why, you know. And then basically, if you don't accept that, then you're mental. You need drugs. You need to be medicated. And so then it gets people even more angry. You know, it's like they're giving me these two ridiculous options. Neither one are right. So they're building up this anger, building the anger, but they just keep doubling down, saying, wow, these people are getting more irrational all the time. I mean, there's nothing they could possibly be upset about. So they're just like mean-spirited and hate women, and that's why. But of course, if the women are the ones who are employing this tactic that intentionally, in which they are, then of course you're going to be very angry at them, justifiably too, right? I mean, they're saying, hey, you can't be angry at we're trashing your values, because we're going to claim that you're really angry at women in general. You know, therefore you're a wicked, evil person. Well, of course you're going to be angry at that person in particular for hiding this trashing behind your skirt, you know? That's like super devious and mean. And then they say, no, to generalize it. No. Like they said to Trump, you've called women fat, ugly, slob, dogs, but you're so mean to women. Why are you so mean to women? Why do you hate women? You're so mean to them, you know? And Trump said, no, I only called one person that, you know, which wasn't exactly true. But, you know, if some woman's really mean to him, he will say, hey, you know, she's a fat slob or something, you know, or whatever. He'll be mean back. But they tried to generalize it, saying, you hate all women, you're mean to all women. And he said, no, I'm not. That's a lie. So he caught them in a severe lie. Severe lie. You know? But when you get so many flood the zone of reporters with so many women who are coming at you in so many different ways, and then you have to fend that off, then they could say, look, you're mean to her, you're mean to her, you're mean to her, you're mean to her, so you must hate all women, you know. I say, no, I'm just pushing back against the operatives of destruction, that's all. But it's easy then to generalize if you see a pattern. So, well, I see a pattern here. And so they try to induce people to believe in this non-existent pattern by, you know, operative number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, 10, whatever. They were all trying to, you know, cut his legs off, and he fought back against every one of them. They say, hey, wait a minute, the common denominator, they're all women, therefore he must hate all women. You see, folks, there's a pattern there. And so they try to induce these false patterns in this way. They're very, very clever, the architects of destruction and trashing. They're very, well, that's not that clever, really, is it? I mean, yeah, that's kind of juvenile, actually. That's the kind of stuff you dream up when you're like in, you know, fourth grade or something. It's like, hey, you know, let's try this one. Let's try this one. They're kind of stuck in a juvenility, thinking that means that they're young. You know, we're still doing stuff that we did when we were kids. You know, we must still be young and vital. So certainly, you know, those who are trying to trumpet, you know, we're moving on from the past by trashing it, you know, they're trying to steal the thunder from Jesus. They're steal the thunder from Jesus, really. They're trying to say, hey, we don't need Jesus. We know how to move on properly. I mean, what do we need Jesus for? So of course I have to point out the plurality of what they're doing, and they're not the answer at all. And this has to be brought very, very clearly. Now, obviously, holding on to the past, we don't want to do that either. Okay, so it's easier to see, well, holding on to the past is not it. It's more difficult to see that those who are moving on by trashing are not it, that either, because they're introducing an element of positivity, like, hey, let's move on from the past. You can agree with that, right? So they're doing like this half-truth, and it's more difficult to fend them off, because they're saying, well, you know, look at these crazies, that stuff is wrong, let's move on from it. And so it's more difficult to fend those off, which is why moderates have gotten sucked into their, you know, viciousness of, and supporting this viciousness. You know, they think, well, you know, it's like the Germans, like, well, we got to support the Führer, I guess. You know, I mean, he's doing good for the economy. He's, you know, helping us with this, and I, you know, we don't want to rock the boat too much, and it's like that. The moderates get sucked into supporting radical activists, even though they're uncomfortable about it. They may say, wow, I just don't see any option. Well, Jesus is the option, really, not the Jesus of the church, not the Jesus of religion, the Jesus of accommodation, the Jesus who knows about this is all pretension, okay? The Jesus knows this is all scripted pretension. We're the ones scripting it. It's not really evolving. We're scripting it. The Jesus who knows about flattening out concepts and flattening out the past, flattening it all out. The Jesus who knows all about and respects and honors and are wanting to honor our creativity. The Jesus who preteaches the intermediate step of this flattening out and honoring our creativity, who's all about teaching this intermediate step, who's not trying to get us to simply make it all vanish, no. The Jesus who does not want to trash anything we've done, who respects all our creativity. They need to know about this Jesus. This is the real Jesus. This is the Jesus I know. This is the real Jesus. This is not the Jesus of religion. It's the same Jesus that was here before, but it's not the Jesus of the religion that got spun around him like a cocoon by fearful minds, by minds that were worried and concerned and ignorant and fearful and still trying to pretend that they were dead, so how could they understand what Jesus was talking about? I can't understand what Jesus is talking about. I'm dead. I'm not spirit anymore. I need to be spirit to understand what Jesus is talking about. So how do I, you know, I can't really get what he has to say. I blow my cover. It's pretty cool, this Hubert's lemonade bottles. There's a little trick that you, when you drink it and finish the original bottle full of lemonade or limeade, cherry limeade, this, Don't rinse it out. Don't rinse it out. I haven't actually done this, but I rinse it out. But still, there's a flavor still in it. So when you pour the water in, it gets this subtle lemon-flavored water. It's very good. But if you didn't rinse it out at all, you'd probably be able to drink many, 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 many times, and it would still have this you know, great tinge of flavored water for you. So flavored water for free. Very cool. Flavored water for free. How are we doing here? I can hardly see. 208. Yeah. 208. Great. Great. Now, we're given this time, as we should give it time, because this is a really a revelation, isn't it? It's a very intense revelation here. And I do ping pong back and forth, and to, you know, I point out the tradition, how it was a side trip, so it was very mistaken. So I pointed out how mistaken that is. And then I pointed out of trying to move on by trashing the past, how vicious and mistaken that is, and how all the tricks that they're using. So you don't get caught in either one of these camps. I mean, I'm bringing both camps to light. It's not like I'm favoring one over the other. You know, we don't have to favor one over the other. We really don't. Because, yes, we do need to move on. Yes, it was a mistake. But those who are moving on don't even understand the mistake of it, really. They don't see it clearly. They just realize, well, this didn't work, and so we have to bring in some more authentic death. We're going to different try. They realize it didn't work. That doesn't mean they really know why it didn't work. They're ignorant of it. So they're very blind to the situation. Possibility that Trump runs a third party, and that could create real chaos actually in the country. It's real. It would almost, you know, bring almost like a civil war type of atmosphere here, which is already very much fermenting actually. Unacknowledged, you know, just putting down those who are upset, just putting them down as crazies and not acknowledging what they could be upset about, and just demonizing with words like, you know, phobic this, phobic this, phobic this, phobic this. Again, to call someone phobic is a very nasty, what you're really saying is they have a mental disease, mental disorder. And of course, it's really interesting now that the progressives are putting out all these movies that are grandizing mental disorders of various types. Except, you never hear none of these things ever talk about phobias. They're phobic, I'm phobic, you know, like that mental disorder, no. So what they're saying is all these other mental disorders will give you a pass. They're okay, they're actually heroic, you know, heroic, which is, you know, utter not, they're terrible. I mean, those who are suffering don't think they're being heroic, really. I mean, they say, well, I want relief from this. This is hideous. But they're trying to say, no, 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 you guys are like, you're something wonderful about you. And so they're trying to get rid of, redefine mental illness so it suits their definition of this phobia that, you know, those who want to have traditional values have suffered. They're the ones who are really suffering from mental illness. They have this severe phobia. They're the ones who are truly mentally ill. But in order to do this, they need to kind of redefine mental illness. So this is why you get these movies being produced now, which is the new mania by these progressives who are trying to, you know, completely change the landscape of what mental illness is. And to call someone phobic is to say they have just they're completely irrational, is what they're really saying. They're suffering from a severe irrationality. They're incapable of being reasonable. Therefore, they're dangerous, certainly can't have guns, and need to be medicated, heavily medicated, and re-educated. This is exactly the intensity of what we're dealing with here right now. There's this spate of these movies about mental illness come out and you know, demonizing the opponents of radical progressives as phobic, you're just phobic. They don't even listen to the arguments anymore. This is what I've seen. And the back and forth of it is the traditionalists will say, "Hey, wait a minute! You're trashing our traditions. We like our traditions. Why are you doing this?" And then the other person will say, "You're phobic. You have a severe phobia. You're phobic." So in other words, there's no dialogue. There's just someone complains. Say, "Hey, wait a minute! You know, I want dialogue on this." And somebody else saying, "I can't. There's what dialogue about what? You're phobic. You have a mental disease. This is where it's at right now. This is where it's at." Now, I know what a phobia is. I had arachnophobia, fear of spiders, and I was able to overcome it through enormous efforts of will and intelligence and wisdom of gradually desensitizing. So I know that's irrational, right? Irrational, that irrational fear of spiders. And so what you're really, saying is that these people are fundamentally irrational on very fundamentally basic things. Now, fear of a spider is some incidental, trivial thing, you know. But when you call somebody with core values like marriage and saying that your disagreement is not really a disagreement, it's evidence of a phobia, which means you're completely irrational about it. There's no reason, like people say, there's no reason whatsoever to be afraid of spiders, basically, right? It's completely irrational. They're using the same term, phobic, to mean that people, for example, who want to support traditional marriage are completely phobic. They're phobic. They're completely irrational. There's no basis whatsoever to how they feel. It's an irrational phobia. And then to extend this to all the rest of their values, what they're basically saying is they're completely irrational. And so how can you have a dialogue with someone who's completely irrational? You can't. So what they're really saying is, when they say you're phobic, meaning they're really saying is you need medication, plain and simple, which they call re-education. But in today's terms, re-education is medication. You got Nurse Ratched running the country, basically. That's an allusion to One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest movie, which... In the days when I actually did watch some movies, I think I saw that on television, you know, once. I said, "What's this about? Let me see. Nurse Ratched. Okay, now I get it." Who loved to keep everyone medicated? She's just doing it. She's helping them. She's compassionate. Keeping their phobias. Treat it under control, so they wouldn't irrationally oppose what we know is good and just and right. We know we must move on from this, from all the past. You know, they say all the past is wrong. You know, traditional marriage, crazy. Why did anybody think of that thing? It's absolutely, we've got to move on from it. Come on, you're kidding me. You know, so anyone who doesn't move on is phobic. This is their underlying and needs medication. So they're hand in hand with the pharmaceutical industry. The pharmaceutical industry says, "Great, we love what you're doing. Yeah, convince all these people that they have a severe mental problem, and we'll just be able to get them hooked on medicine for the rest of their life. And since it doesn't work, we'll give them more. Double down on that, and we'll drain every last ounce of their money, suck them dry like a blood-sucking parasite." And then plus there'll be zombies, medicated zombies, and so it's a win-win. We all win. They get cured of their phobia, or at least it's under control. You get to trash the past and move on, and we get all these obscene profits. And so it's like triple win. We all win. We all win. This is how they think. This is really how they think. And here is Jesus saying, whoa, hold on, everybody. You know, I got a better way. I got a better way. Let's stop being really, really whimsical. You know, over the top whimsical here. This is there's a much, much better way here, and that's all I'm saying. There's a better way. Let's do it this better way, way better way, immeasurably better way. And we don't have to keep to calling these people. Let's back off of the rhetoric here. Let's back off this. Back off the drugs. Back off the rhetoric. Back off the drugs. Back off the trashing. Let's be forgiving, loving, forgiving, wise, disciplined. Let's have a right theology. Okay, let's have a right Christology. Let's move on, but let's also honor the past. So this practice of saying, yes, I'm both trying and not trying. I'm both moving on and not moving on. This helps us accept this and accepts the flattening of it all. Because, yes, I am moving on. The glasses, you know, I am moving on, but I'm doing it by honoring the past, you see. It's flattened there for me, but I'm honoring it. So yes, I'm moving on and I'm not moving on. See that? So this honors both. The whole situation is honored. So it's the truly honorable way. This is the true honoring. We're honoring our own creativity. We're honoring it by moving on, and we're honoring it by flattening the past and letting that stay for a while. Both of these are honoring the same creativity, not two different creativities. The same creativity is produced all this dream. It's that same creativity that now decides, says, you know what, I want to move on from this, but I don't want to do it by just...